So welcome to Couchtop Chemistry this month. I can't believe it's taken me this long to get around to doing this. We're this month going to be looking at one of the most iconic chemistry demonstrations of all time. This is the Briggs-Rauscher oscillating reaction. So what you're going to need are four different solutions. First of all, I've got some 10-vol hydrogen peroxide. If you want this reaction to work, make sure it legitimately is. The last couple of times I've gone through and picked up a bottle that just said 10-vol on it, it wasn't. Make it up fresh and the old reaction will definitely work nicely. Second solution I've got here is some potassium iodate in 0.1 molar sulfuric acid. And then I've got some freshly made, again important is freshly made starch solution. And if you're making up the starch solution, this reaction absolutely hates chloride ions, so don't forget to make sure that you're using deionized water, not just tap water, for making up the starch, and you'll have much better results coming out of that. My final solution here has got some malonic acid. The full ingredients for all of the solutions are, as always, available down in the links below. On the EIC website, go and check them out there as well for all of the safety information as well. Okay, so you want to be starting off with about, say, 15-20 mil of each of the other solutions and about 1 mil of the starch. Going in this order, so I'm beginning with the peroxide. Followed by the iodate in the sulfuric acid. Then about a mil of starch as some indicator for us. And then finally the malonic acid. So what follows next is a bit of an induction period. During this time, the iodate is reacting, we're generating slowly a solution of essentially iodine in potassium iodide, which is giving us that sort of familiar straw orange color. But we're not getting the starch complex just yet because we need a critical concentration of iodide ions in order for the starch complex to actually fully realize. So this initial induction period here, we're building up this orange color, but it's only when that combination of iodine and iodide hit that crucial concentration that we get a beautiful immediate change to that black classic starch complex that we're looking to generate. And there she is. And during this time, of course, we have our malonic acid, which is actually reacting with the iodine again. Okay, and that's actually flipping our reaction back in the other direction. And once we've got this induction period over, now we get some nice fast switches between the starch complex, the iodine in iodide, and our colourless solution, where we have very low levels of iodine and iodide as well. Now this will cycle over the next couple of minutes, eventually leading up to a position where all of the malonic acid is gone and we're left behind with an iodine-iodide complex and some iodine, of course, left over at the end. Now this reaction is totally bomb-proof. If you've made up the solutions, if the peroxide is decent, then you can actually scale this up and down really nicely. So whether it's 20 drops of each of the other solutions and one drop of the starch, or 5 drops and one drop of the starch, whether you want to scale it up as well, works really nicely. Now the nice thing about working with puddles or small droplets is that you can get all kinds of interesting time-lapse effects if you get your students to watch what's taking place and video it and speed those videos up. Lots of interesting chemistry potentially to talk about there as well. And when the reaction's finished, you find yourself in this situation here where we've got our starch iodine complex And the malonic acid is no longer able to get rid of that. So that's our reaction over and done with. If you're working on a larger scale, you may want to leave the reaction to settle out, decant off the solution from the top, and any remaining iodine react with some sodium thiosulfate before pouring the rest down the sink. Obviously, we wouldn't necessarily want to just dump some sodium thiosulfate straight into here, because with the acid present, there's a chance that we can be producing some sulfur dioxide as well. So there you have it, the Briggs-Rauscher oscillating reaction, a staple of chemistry demonstrations for very good reason, absolutely fascinating thing for students to take a look at, really, really beautiful to watch. Give it a try.